I'm Rosemary McGee, and I'm honored to serve as Director of the Stuart A. Rhodes Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Libraries. And on behalf of Emory Libraries, and Yolanda Cooper is here, University Librarian also, my colleagues Jennifer Meehan, Carrie Hintz, and other Rhodes Library and Woodruff Library representatives. So thank you all for the work that you've done to pull this evening together. This event is also sponsored by the James Weldon Johnson Institute for the Study of Race and Difference at Emory, Emory's English Department, Creative Writing Program, and Fearless Dialogues. And I'm pleased to welcome you on this spring day in February. The mission of the Rhodes Library is to connect and collect stories of human experience, promote access and learning, and offer opportunities for all wise hearts, dialogue, all wise hearts to seek knowledge. There we go. A major figure in the Black Arts Movement, Mari Evans wrote poetry, books for children, music. We're just listening to some of the music and plays. Her papers are perfectly situated in the Rhodes Library, where you all know we celebrate all of these genres and commitments. While she passed away in March 2017 at the age of 97, because of the presence of her papers here, her spirit continues to inspire and enliven us, especially tonight. We have a star-studded program thanks to the vision and persistence of Charmaine Bonner, project archivist, and here to introduce this evening's multidisciplinary unfoldings is the talented Christelle Roach. Christelle is a fourth-year student in Emory College. She is a double major in creative writing and African-American studies, and she's a Mellon Scholar, and she will introduce our panel and our program for tonight. So welcome again.
Blues in B flat. Baby, baby, tell me, what did I do wrong? Baby, baby, tell me, what did I do wrong? Ain't seen your face since Thursday. How come you stay away so long? Baby, you got paid on Friday. Any of your paycheck left? Baby, you got paid on Friday. Any of your paycheck left? Nothing in the icebox, and ain't nothing on the shelf. Have you got another woman? Wash your clothes and cook your meals. Have you got another woman? Wash your clothes and cook your meals. Irregardless, babe, she sure will all can't feel about you like I feel. Baby, baby, tell me, what did I do wrong? Baby, baby, tell me, what did I do wrong? Ain't seen your face since Thursday. How come you stay away so long? Good evening,
good evening,
artists, scholars, students, audience. I am honored to be celebrating Mari Evans' legacy with you all today. When I was first introduced to Mari Evans by Dr. Pelham McDaniels, I was mid-question, asking him about Black women and blues and music. He guided me to a display on Mari Evans in the Rhodes Library, where I read that she was a poet and musician, and I responded, huh, me too. It is in these moments where one finds themselves in another that continuums work. Mari's moment came when she was just a child, reading Langston Hughes' The Weary Blues. She reflects on this in her essay, My Father's Passage, where she speaks of her father's praise of her first poem and moves on to speak with the same nostalgia and enthusiasm about Langston Hughes. She says, when I was about 10, I took a copy of his Weary Blues from the shelf and, eyes bright with discovery, mouth shaped in astonishment, rhapsodized, why, he's writing about me! He was writing my introduction to a Black literary tradition that began on the African continent many millennia ago. While Mari Evans is Black, she is also a woman. She very well may have recognized her Blackness in Hughes' blues poems, but her being a woman drew me to Hughes' words in The Big C, where he speaks of writing these blues poems, saying that he tried to write poems like the songs they sang on 7th Street, with knowledge of race records and the ubiquitous image of a black woman singing blues, one may say that the they that Hughes speaks of are the classic blues women of the 1920s singing in the Cotton Club and in the clubs on Lenox Avenue in Harlem and on 7th Street in Washington, D.C. And the 10-year-old me in Evan's essay grows to be this black woman. Lines from her poem, Blues in B-flat, echo sentiments in Bessie Smith's Empty Bed Blues. I woke up this morning with an awful aching head, woke up this morning with an awful aching head. My new man had left me just a room and an empty bed. Seeing a blues continuum at work, I dove into Mari Evans' poetry just to look, and was open to a world of poems that utilized call and response, manipulated rhythm through syntax, implemented blues stanzas and blues phrases, and ultimately pictured a performance on the page that continued a blues performance tradition. I reached Mari through the blues, and from what I read, she did too. A writer, poet, educator, musician, and activist, Evans was an active figure in the Black Arts Movement. She was published in Langston Hughes's edited volume of New Negro Poets USA in 1964. She published her first book, Where Is All the Music, in 1968. And in 1970, she published her second and most acclaimed book of poems, I Am a Black Woman. Alongside teaching, writing, and criminal justice advocacy, Evans volunteered in primary and secondary schools. She was involved with nonprofit organizations such as Girls Inc. and Greater Indianapolis and the Young Men's Christian Association, YMCA. In 2006, she published her last book, Clarity as a Concept, A Poet's Perspective, which has her 1970 essay, My Father's Passage, in it, where she says, imagery becomes the magic denominator, the language of passage. I am confident that Mari wrote her way into her transition. She passed almost a year ago, on Friday, March 10th, 2017, in Indianapolis, Indiana. She was 97 years old. Perhaps the most direct tribute we can conjure tonight is through Mari Evans' poetry. Students Daquan Wilson, Kira Tucker from Emory University will be reading alongside Maya Mitchell from Spelman College. Dr. Gregory Ellison will follow with a short clip, and Dr. Opal Moore will moderate our panel discussion with Dr. Joanne Gavin, Dr. Althea Tate, and Dr. Betty Parker Smith. Following the panel will be a Q&A, and ultimately the close of our night will be led by our event coordinator, Charmaine Bonner. So first, I'd like to introduce our poets. Daquan Wilson is a freshman from Columbia, South Carolina. At Emory, he is pursuing a double major in African American Studies and Creative Writing with a concentration in poetry. On campus, Daquan is involved in organizations such as Alpha Pi Omega, National Service Fraternity, and the Student Programming Council. Maya Sherilyn Mitchell is a junior English major at Spelman College. She is the editor of The Wave HBCU magazine and marketing and communications manager for The Blueprint. She has also worked as a writer for The Odyssey and Anecdote magazines. Maya's website, loveyourselfma.com, acts as a motivational space for African American women discovering self-love. She became a published poet when she was 16 years old and is inspired by her namesake, Maya Angelou. Maya plans to further her education while pursuing her dream job of becoming editor-in-chief of Teen Vogue. And Kira Tucker is a sophomore English and creative writing major from Memphis, Tennessee native. At Emory, she combines her love of arts and activism through her leadership and as an executive director of the Mental Health and Arts Advocacy Collective, Emory Dark Arts, as well as her involvement as a staff writer of Emory's first and only Black student publication, Emory's Black Star magazine. She also pursues her love of language, social justice, and the arts as a freelance blogger, award-winning slam poet, and nationally honored visual artist. Like Mari Evans, Kira strives daily for successes as a prolific professor and poet extraordinaire. Please help me welcome our student poets as they usher her voice into the space for each of us tonight.
Whisper together, brethren. Whisper together, brethren. Glide through the darkness. Darkness black like you. Glide alone in pairs. Through ancestral blackness where one match burns brighter than 1,000 slogans and one bullet speaks. Louder than 1,000,000 marching feet. For every black man's murdered back, death is the equalizer. There is a company with us that should be, that should cease to be. Whisper together, brethren. Glide through the darkness.
The writers. Where did they go, the writers? Chest pulsing under kente cloth. The word clenched in sweaty fists, strength so awesome, none approached without a questioning, a quickening. Am I incorrect? Oh, tell me, brother, am I incorrect? Where did they go? The writers. With the wisdoms learned from blue steel butts, from cement crypts, and with their ancient sealed potential. They have gone to white land, sister. There, they lie, healed by white lips, soothed by white hands, stoned in white beds, bound again in silken chains, whispering in an alien tongue, litanies. None but me, Miss Annie, none but me, pale comrade, with the quick tongue, with the rock blue eyes. Where did they go? The writers. Beautiful, chest pulsing under kente cloth, the word clenched in sweaty fists. They have gone to white land, sister. Am I incorrect? Oh, tell me, brother, am I incorrect?
Come on!
Who can be born black? Who can be born black and not sing? The wonder of it, the joy, the challenge. Who can be born black and not exult? I am a black woman. I am a black woman. The music of my song, some sweet arpeggio of tears, is written in a minor key. And I can be heard humming in the night. Can be heard humming in the night. I saw my mate leap screaming to the sea. And I, with these hands, cut the life breath from my issue in the canebrake. I lost Nat's swinging body in a rain of tears and heard my son scream all the way from Anzio for peace he never knew. I learned Da Nang and Pork Chop Hill in anguish. Now my nostrils know the gas and these trigger-tired fingers seek the softness in my warrior's beard. I am a black woman, tall as a cypress, strong, beyond all definition, still defying place and time and circumstance, assailed, impervious, indestructible. Look on me and be renewed. The rebel. When I die, I'm sure I will have a big funeral. Curiosity seekers coming to see if I am really dead or just trying to make trouble.
All right.
Fearless Dialogues, and among other things, I am a student of Ms. Marr, a friend. She was a wise teacher and a sage for me, and And in many ways, a grandmother, she would be so upset when we said But Charmaine graciously offered me this opportunity to share some insights about how Ms. Mari has impacted my life. But in good faith, I could not do so, having Ms. Mari's own grandson here. So in lieu of my words, I would invite Mr. Eric Fenster to come and share.
I just want to say thanks for everyone coming out this evening in honor of my grandmother. Just wonderful, powerful individual. Her power, her presence just radiates. It's beyond the poetry, the word. It's just who she was in her spirit. A very powerful individual. We called her Mom Mary. And we had a real close bond growing up. And she was like my life coach, you know, and my teacher. Every time I was faced with difficulty, she was right there. Every step of my life since I was a small child. She's just a consummate teacher. And I'm so proud of her, and I'm so proud to be here just to see that her work is being recognized in the way that it is. And so, yeah, we're just so very proud. And I think every panel of sisters here, very powerful. Ms. Ellison, yes. And Charmaine, thank you. Yes. I just want to say thank you and thanks for coming out.
Everybody, this is a video of Ms. Mari, and I, she would call me up and have a list of things for me to do. during our break, she would sit at the piano and play, and on this rare occasion, I asked her to read a poem because I share her poetry. There are a few of my students in the room. I share her poetry with my students, so I asked her if she would kindly read a poem. You will see the personality of Ms. Mari come out in this poem, and before she reads the poem, but here it is.
Need any of these qualities to be externally determined? This is what she said. I am African first, African with a K. Then a woman, and then a writer, who must deliver her politics through the Black aesthetics. As a very impressive and passionate human being, Mari was petite in stature, always fashionably dressed, spoke deeply with a soft touch, called all Black women sister, and remain loyal, this is important, to her 12-inch jet black Afro hairstyle until near the end of her lifespan when she allowed her fro to showcase its beautiful gray. When she couldn't go by the hair color. She was very close to her two tall and handsome sons, a position she maintained throughout their lives, Eric and Evans, both of whom preceded her in death. She never accepted their deaths as rites of passage. In fact, the man did something to her boys. And while we are aware of her multifaceted talent bank as a pianist, a jazz enthusiast, playwright, essayist, all that you've just heard, what we are most awed by is her political trademark of racial oppression, along with her vociferous outcry of the domestic treatment of African-American women. In this regard, her poetry is highly confrontative and models her activist trademark. Her poems reflect what the literary critic Clarence Major coined as weapon poems, with a radical presence and carried a flame of resistance and a promise of recovery. So to prevent any misunderstanding of her life work as a writer, she left her own statement of clarity in a book that she published that you just heard about called Clarity as a Concept, A Poet's Perspective. And she tells us that her political vision is a continuation of her father's passage. He was a rather small figure of a man who was particularly stylish, and she described him as an oak of a man who kept her first form written when she was four. She never lived outside of her father's shadow, and of him she wrote in a poem entitled Oral History, Found Poetry. She said, you know, my father, filled with memory, would say, I never took no stuff from off no peckerwood. Neither did my daddy, nor his daddy before him. Never fought their wars, never joined their army. Neither me nor my daddy, nor his daddy, nor his daddy before him. No siree, Bob.
No siree, Bob.
Your great-grandfather, Reese, was lynched just outside Atlanta. And they run your Uncle Morris out of Macon. Yet and still, we never took no stuff. That's found in Dark and Splendid, Mass, in case anybody's interested. I think of myself, she said, as a political writer. And it is to my father that I attribute my political fortitude and the power of the written word. And giving credit to Margaret Walker, she announced, I write for my people. So considering that the primary ingredient in her politics is racial oppression, which creates a cloak of vulnerability, it therefore became her role as a writer to realign this unnatural situation so that African Americans can regain their rightful place as full human beings. She said, we have screamed and filled our lungs with revolutionary rhetoric. We've learned to mourn. If ever we should rise, we could reorder space and time. Further, Maury's loyalty to combating race as a construct positioned her as a respected card-carrying member of the race by her male comrades during the movement. She often bemoaned the fact that publishers rejected her writings on race, but gladly published her writings on women. Considering that Maury has been a muse of poetry for some time now and struggled amongst a confluence of historical circumstances, her poetics have obviously borne the reflection of her circumstances as an African-American woman. Her seminal book of poetry that you've heard from for the last hour, I'm a Black Woman, produces a collage of poems that are deeply personal and deeply committed to the orchestra that plays the Black woman's blues. She captures the essence of the historical suffering of her female counterparts, the disappointments, the abuse, the suffering, the pain, the sorrow. And the reader gets to get so caught up in a plethora of agony and pain from which the black woman has suffered, that the endings of her poem provide a release that is welcomed and often surreal. In this regard, Hoyt Fuller said of her that her language is sparse and uncomplicated, but her simplicity is deceptive. Hoyt was one of Lamar's closest friends, and lamenting his untimely death, she wrote a long poem for him called Brother, Comrade, Confidant. And in it, she agonized. She said, listen, just put death on hold and labor for another lifetime. Poems, and I'm a black woman, are infused with the remarkable versatility of shape and language, as you've heard tonight, and surprise word endings, like The Insurgent speaks to freedom as being non-negotiable. And The Alarm Clock, where she ends it by saying, and I woke up quick. It don't do to wake up quick. And with Where Have You Gone? She addresses the economic distress, the psychological abuse, and the challenge of maintaining healthy romantic relationships. She said, Where have you gone with your confident walk, with your crooked smile? Why'd you leave me when you took your laughter and departed? Are you aware that with you went the sun, all light, and what few stars there were? Where have you gone with your confident walk, your crooked smile? And watch this ending, the rent money in one pocket. Of course, now, it's very easy to observe that her poetry is characterized by a tendency to pack her final lines so that the reader is jolted by them. Of course, there is the physical abuse, which paints high levels of endurance as African-American women stare the evils of racism, sexism, and racial and sexual abuse straight in the face, while they search for temporary spaces to store their pain. Mari allows them the fortitude to hold on, make do, find the strength to manage broken hearts as they carry the world on their shoulders. Yet they are clear that this state of victimization is temporary. So now, the Black Hearts Movement, an arm of the Black Power Movement to which Mari was a significant artist and activist, operated on the notion that resistance to systematic social injustice is a natural human response. And Mari felt that her role as writer-activist was to capture this evil and enshrine it. Here it is. There's no doubt that Mari was a rebel, and she invites the reader to come to her pages uncluttered, because she says, you know, I'm going to rise en masse. I'm tired of this messing me over. Going to breathe fire, and I'm going to wear the robes and make the arrests and put angels in all the books and a black child in Mary's arms. She took her politics and read her poetry at conferences, community sites, churches, classrooms. She was a member of what I coined as the Traveling Professoriate Club. Among this list were her comrades, Hoyt Fuller, John Henry Clark, Ben Yochanan, Walter Rodney, and others. They did short stints of teaching at many colleges and universities. You've already heard that Mari taught at Cornell University, Spelman, Northwestern, Indiana, Florida International, among others, and delivered her package of politics to her students. and to the grassroots communities. And she didn't fly. So her youngest son, Derek, who transitioned to throat cancer, escorted her all over America in her Fords and Chevrolets, on Greyhound buses and railways. She had a strong network of writers and artists. They were buddies and friends, sisters and brothers who had a collective Black consciousness which spoke to the concerns of the Black community that was under siege by the white community. So through I Am a Black Woman, Mari Evans became the voice for Black women. And as a woman of African descent, she actually exercised her prerogatives and used her talents to register her discontent. And she left us understanding that I'm a Black woman, tall as a cypress, strong beyond all definition and still defined place and time and circumstance. A cell, impervious, indestructible. Just look on me and be renewed.
Would you really please just warmly thank these fabulous scholars? I will say that I think this is what scholarships should sound like, that it comes straight from the heart. And not romantically in that sense, but the kind of knowledge that you share out of love. I know that all of the students who sit in the classrooms or have sat in the classrooms of these scholars have felt loved through knowledge sharing. And so I want to thank you personally, each one of these wonderful women who have contributed so much to my life as well. I don't know whether we have any limitations on time, but I do want to make sure that the audience has an opportunity to speak back to these scholars and these tellers of the story of Mari Evans. And I just want to say that one of my most wonderful experiences was being invited to JMU to give a presentation, and I said to her class, you know, I've always wanted in reading poems to an audience to have someone stand up and tell me a poem back. And somebody stood up and told me a poem back. So tell your poem back to these poets.
Has the beard began?
Yes.
I would like to ask. Out of a tremendous love for not only theology, but specifically for Jesus Christ, who comes up under so much scrutiny in Western theology, what they would say about, I am a woman, Mari Evans, in terms of womanist theology, where that bent is, and how you perceive that in her and your own lives.
Well, maybe I could start with that, because that's something that I felt that Mari knew about. Mari was a woman of faith, but she showed that she was a spiritual woman because of what she shared about love. And you've heard some love poems here. I used to do Hold My Hand, which I thought was just an amazing poem. But I'm going to take, I suppose, a suggestion from Mari herself, because Eric will tell you that Maury put together her own funeral service. She decided what poems would be in there. So there's one poem that has not been read that I'd like to read, and it'll show you the deepness of this woman's heart, because that's what the religion that she practiced believed in. It's called Celebration, and I'll just say this. Maury was faithful. She came to every celebration that I had at James Madison University. She got on that Amtrak and she came those miles, or she got a ride, but she came to the celebration for Lucille Clifton. 73 poems for 73 years. Jericho was there, and she let us off. She was the dean, so she let us off. She came to share her fortune, and Opal and Jericho and others were there. But she was about love and celebration. Celebration. I will bring you a whole person, and you will bring me a whole person. And we will have us twice as much of love and everything. I'll be bringing you a whole heart, and while it do have nicks and dents and scars, that only makes me lay it down more careful-like. And you'll be bringing a whole heart, a little chipped and rusty, and sometimes skip a beat, but still and all, you bring in polish, too. It looked like you intend to make it shine. And we'd be bringing, each of us, the music of ourselves to wrap the other in, forgiving clarities, soft as a choir's last lingering note, our personal blend. I will be bringing you someone whole, and you will be bringing me someone whole. And we be twice as strong, and we be twice as true, and we will have twice as much of love and everything. That's Maury Evans.
I want to just add something to that.
Yeah, because the womanist question is.
No. This is, I think, everything, this poem that Dr. Gavin just read, I think it celebrates womanism, right, and womanist theology. Whether you're coming through Katie Cannon's journal text, right? And that also being in conversation, right, with what womanists and black feminists were doing at the same time through Alice Walker, through Ovinyemi, right? Coming out of the 70s into the 80s, that there was to be a rejection of separatism, right? That the radical space would not work for these black women who were dually resisting sexism as well as racism. And coupling that with sort of energizing what they were doing in the churches, right? The churches being a mobilized force in whatever way that they could. And you saw that in the poem that she just read, this sort of celebration of becoming whole, right? Which is very germinal to womanist theology and theory in general, because there's literary criticism, right, and the theological space. And that there's what, a wholeness, that you pursue wholeness for everyone, right?
As opposed to feminism, which was separate from womanism.
That's a larger discussion that would probably take 3 hours.
Yeah. Her position.
So I don't want to, and the reason why I stay away from that, because one of the things that I'm resisting in my scholarship on Maury Evans is that she's so complex. Yes. And we are amiss if we oversimplify things, and I don't want to do the injustice to this discourse and to the work she gave us by trying to wrap it up in these sort of labelized spaces. I think we get into trouble then in that area. But I honor you for the question. I think it's very valid, and I think that the poem speaks very powerfully to what she was accomplishing in a woman's fair. And she would tell you, if she didn't want something, she asked for some bulk ground beef. I didn't know what bulk was, so I went to the butcher in Marshall. I said, give me some best ground beef. I think she wanted ground chuck or something. And he gave it to me packaged, and she said, you got a PhD, you don't know what bulk is.
I said, maybe I'm gonna have to, I had to choke back the tears for a moment here.
And she got on the phone, called the church, and she said, I think the woman's name was Sister Marie. She said, you tell Sister Marie to come by my house and get this ground chuck so she can make a family some of those wonderful meatballs that she does. She's very connected and holistic. And she was so, even with churches that were universal, that were inclusive. So she wasn't about separatism. Regardless of someone's race or their orientation or their class. So I just don't want to oversimplify what she accomplished. But thank you.
If we don't, just one second. I started not to even respond to your question because I'm not sure I understood all of it. But this is what I know.
Your microphone.
Oh, I'm sorry. My response was whether or not I understood your question enough to respond to it. But this is what I know about my friend, Maury Evans, who we were friends for 50 years. The question may arise, and probably has, was Maury a feminist? I think the problem one could get into is to say, wasn't she a feminist? You see, I will say this to you. She was highly spiritual. And everything she talked about, the wrongdoings of this, she did it out of the gut of spirituality. Whatever you want to call it. That was mine.
Thank you. And I had the privilege of hosting Mari when she was expelled. She came under the Living and Learning Program, so it's my responsibility to work with visiting scholars. And it's in that capacity that I got to know that she became my friend. And afterwards, I would call her. I hosted her in our home. One of the things about Mari that was incredible to me is that she always had this spirit of learning something new. There's always something about it that seemed like, well, that really happened. Tell me more about that. Always, even though I knew she had all these incredible experiences and had, you know, traveled and written and what have you. And, you know, I would call her, and one day I called and I was trying, she was a mentor. And I was working through a situation, and she said, well, Langston was saying. And I said, who's she talking about, Langston Johnson? Langston Smith? No, Langston Hughes. And so it was an incredible interaction between she and I. She really left a footprint in Spelman. And I don't, and it was so interesting to hear the students recite, I am a black woman, with so much bravado. And then when she got on the stage to say it, it was that silent strength of that very poem. So I miss her, but I thank you all for the wonderful comments, your insights on her. It's just a treasure that brings back a friend, a mentor to me. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we have to close the program. I would like to take at least one more question before we do that. One more.
Hello.
Yes.
I'll take that question. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. It's one thing to be in an archive, but it's another to be hearing voices and being touched by them. I wrote down my question because I didn't want to lose it. And specifically as a student, sometimes as we combat imposter syndromes and whatnot, and we're in a very vulnerable space where there's a lot of knowledge that it's impossible to know it all, simply because we didn't live it. I was wondering, how do we stray from misinterpreting her voice as we rummage through her archive, looking at it as a sort of a body? How do we bring her words to life inside of scholarship and research without falling into intellectual ventriloquism? That's a great question. And it shows, what school are you coming from?
Emory.
And you know, that's why this space is so important, because there is this body of work that Dr. Tate is going through, where she is going to, I hope, write the first full-length critical book on Mari Evans' work. She has said that she's not studied the way she's supposed to be studied. And so when she touches this information, she's going to bring analysis to it that will allow us to see the multifaceted parts of Mari Evans. So since she has touched these archives, I'm going to give this mic to her.
Thank you, Dr. I think it's really important. There were moments that I had to walk out of the archive and weep, because I saw this woman on one side. I actually wrote something, and I'll read it to you, because it is a better answer. It is a holy thing to touch the figures you scribbled into aged and leaves, the color of skin beneath the bark. Like tracing the commandments written by God's finger. The imprint is still there. A literary sexagenarian pounds us of hunger and anticipation. And I still scratch my head, how did you hear them? The words? How did you pen the people's salty labor clinging to their marching limbs in 1961? With so little, hunger is a trap. Because if you go in there and you look at that woman's dental pads, on one side she's writing poetry, on the other side is her budget of figuring out how she's going to get her rent paid and her food for her 2 points. If you look at the time she rejected lucrative contracts because they were reducing black people to stereotypes. She turned down a contract with a TV station in New York City that wanted to do a series on black people. And she sent the script back to the producer. She said, sir, have you and your people taken a look at the descriptions of the black children in the script versus the white children? And you juxtapose it in the timeline of that stenograph notebook where she's trying to figure out where her rent is coming. And then you see her response to it. I cannot oblige you and your team for this production. If you look at the letter she wrote back and forth to Ether's Knight when he was in a hospital bed fighting his demons of heroin addiction, and he tells her, thank you for sending me the cash. I desperately needed it. And yet, you juxtapose it at the same time period, she's trying to figure out where her rent money is coming from. Mm. You go into the archive knowing it is a living thing that you witness. And there's been much feminist scholarship on leveling this disciplinary, superficial behavior that you go in there as a researcher and they are the subject. No, they are people, and you are a person. And you sit there and you wait for revelation. Anybody can produce knowledge. That's what we have. We have people walking around with products of knowledge. They become talking products of knowledge. I don't own a TV. I'm about to block video clips on certain news stations because they're talking products of knowledge and no revelation. Because revelation brings paradigm shifts, it brings changes, it brings healing. So when you go into the archive, you go with humility. And you sit there and say, what do you have to tell me? This summer I was on my writing retreat in Winston-Salem, and my dear friends are 8 minutes from Wake Forest. I could not be near Wake Forest and not go into Maya's papers, who was very much a dear friend of Mari Evans. And I went in, and it was July 26, 2017, and I just happened to pull out a file, and there was a letter she was writing to Harry Belafonte, July 28, 1976, my birth year. And I looked at the graduate student and I said, this is why we come into the archive. This is what waits for us. So you level the superficiality of intellect being a god. It is a tool. That's what you come here for, to get a tool that you marry to the purpose of helping people. That's what a degree is. That's what I tell my students. And you wait for revelation. It will speak.
Tell the truth to the people. And we want Mari to close out our program. We're going to play this last bit of it.
I write because there are things that I feel are imperative that I have to share with my people. And there are issues that concern us that must be dealt with, and you can deal with them very effectively through the medium of poetry and other forms of literature. Especially through poetry, because it's concise and you can say so much in 8 or 9 lines that people can remember that can touch on very important social issues. So, for me, the germ of the idea is part of the problem or part of the solution, you know. Mm-hmm. And I write from an urgency, a compulsion to share a certain truth that I feel I have. And that's how I write, and that's why I write. I could not write.
Yes, I know.